السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.
وعليكم السلام ورحمة الله وبركاته.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما، وألحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري، واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. What was the last topic? Yes, Ghazwat Tabuk. Yes. So last time we spoke about the Battle of Tabuk, and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he finished that battle and went back to Medina. One more thing we didn't mention before, because the time was limited at last lecture. On the way of going back to Medina, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave order to some Sahaba to go back to Medina very fast. Why? You know?
Because
of Masjid Dirar. Masjid Dirar. What is Masjid Dirar? Some munafiqin, because you know, in every time, in every nation, there is righteous people, there is normal people, there is munafiqin. Every time. Even at the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there is munafiqin. And whatever he is trying to do something for da'wah, or trying like to invite some people for Islam, trying to do anything, munafiqin stop him. Try to just like shackle him or do anything to disturb him. That's munafiqin. So munafiqin wanted to build masjid inside Medina to be the center for them to do any plan and to organize themselves inside Medina. And they already built the masjid. Someone sent to them the money and they gathered and they built the masjid in Medina. Then when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to go for Tabuk, they invited him to pray inside that masjid. He say, sorry, I'm busy. Because he wanted to go to the battle. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like give him the revelation and told him those are munafiqin and they are just planning to disturb Medina and to destroy Medina, and that masjid will be their center. So it's not masjid, it will be Masjid Dirar. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in Quran, وَالَّذِينَ اتَّخَذُوا مَسْجِدًا دِرَارًا. This is a verse in Surah At-Tawbah. Like this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself called that masjid, Masjid Dirar. Because it's not masjid, it's just for planning and destroying Islam. So he sent some sahaba to destroy that masjid before even Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived to Medina. Then they went there and they burned that masjid. Yes. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam arrived to Medina, those, as I mentioned in last lecture, those Sahaba who didn't participate in Battle of Tabuk, they said their excuse and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives them already, and this story finished. And those the famous three Sahaba also, their story is finished. Now Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam want to put end for those munafiqin. Why? Because whenever he go for any battle, whenever he try to give da'wah, whenever to try to do anything, they just disturb da'wah and make secret plans against Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and against Muslimin. So he want to like finish this like mas'ala, it's became over. So he gather all Muslims in the Masjid al-Nabawi. And he gives them khutbah. Start in alhamdulillah, nahmadu wa nasta'in, give khutbah. Then he said, amma ba'd, there are some munafiqin among you. Like this, directly. First time to speak like that. He say, there are some munafiqin among you. Whoever I will mention his name, get out of here. Like this. Then he say, the name of son of that person, the son of that person, like Ahmed ibn Muhammad, whatever he mentioned some name, stand up, get out of here. He count 36 person inside the masjid. All of them munafiqin. And he has been kicked out of the masjid. even though he didn't mention the boss of Munafiqin. Who is him? Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. The boss of Munafiqin. He didn't mention him. You know why? Because everyone knows that he's Munafiqin. Everyone knows he's like, he's very, very, very famous person. So everyone knows that he is Munafiq. So he don't need to mention him anymore. He mentions those no one knew about them. Even though they are very powerful Munafiqin. 36%. He mentioned them one by one. And he has been kicked out of the masjid. When Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul heard about this like accident and his assistant has been exposed and he can't do any nifaq anymore, he got sick. And that kind of sickness became a reason of his death. So he got sick because of sadness and now he is like dying. So he asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come to visit him because he's dying. He's munafiq and asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam to come to visit him. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam came to him, he started to mention about Yahud. He said, I hope if Jewish people come to visit me, I love them. He's dying. And he's mentioned who? Yahud. Subhanallah, the person, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala like seal his heart, you can't change him. It's impossible. His heart has been sealed. He is munafiq, 100% munafiq. So he can't say anything except nifaq. So he say, I love Yahud, I miss them, I hope if they can come. He's dying. A few minutes and he will die. And he speak about Yahud and I love them and I want them to come to visit me. Subhanallah. Then he asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for one thing. He say, if I die, please make my kafan your clothes. Like put your clothes on me so to be my kafan. And please you pray, like you lead the prayer of janazah. This is about Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Although if you remember that Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, he is the person who accused Umm al-Mu'min Aisha radiallahu anha that she did some big mistake. Same person. He is the same person. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned him in Quran several times. And he did many things starting from the battle of Uhud, and before it, battle of Bani Qaynuqa, and he protected Yahud. He did many, many bad things, and he betrayed Muslims many times. Even though Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam still have mercy for everyone. Mercy. When someone speaks about your own wife, and he says she is doing like this and this, and you know that she is the most pure woman on the earth. And Allah revealed Quran to speak about her. But he still have that kind of forgiveness and mercy for that munafiq. He died. He said to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, put his clothes on his kafan, like his kafan, and he leads the prayer. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu said, Ya Rasulullah, you should not pray for that person. Because he's munafiq. Why you pray janazah for this munafiq? He said, it's like maybe Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will like forgive him. I just try. So after Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam leads that prayer and pray on him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Quran. He said, وَلَا تُصَلِّ عَلَىٰ أَحَدٍ مِّنْهُمْ مَاتْ أَبَدًا وَلَا تَكُمْ عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ. You are not allowed to pray janazah for any munafiq anymore. Even you are not allowed to go for his qabr graveyard and give dua. Not allowed. It's clear hukm from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is about Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came back to Medina after the Battle of Tabuk, and many people, especially Arab people, heard about what happened between Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Roman Empire, and the Roman army couldn't even fight against Muslims. Then they understood how powerful Islam and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became. Then people started to come for like accepting Islam. Very big group came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Their name is Bani Tamim. Their leader is Al-Aqra ibn Habis. But they didn't come easily to just declare Islam. They came for showing their pride. So those group came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam by the hafshar, the person who give like butchery for everyone, and khatib, a person who give khutbah. So they came at Zuhr time. So Zuhr time, at that time, people take nap, like sleep maybe 30 minutes or one hour. It's almost like that in that time. So everyone is taking rest and is hot, and everyone is sleeping in his house. And those people came, Ya Muhammad, oh Muhammad, like shouting out from outside. Calling who? Calling Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the highest person ever. Ya Muhammad, oh Muhammad, like shouting. What kind of akhlaq it is? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Al-Hujurat. Surah Al-Hujurat. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu la tarfa'u aswatakum fawqa sawti an-nabi wa la tajharu lahu bil qawl kajhari ba'dikum li ba'd. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like came and spoke with them. He said, we want to challenge you. Like mufakhara, we are proud and we have a very high level person in speech, giving khutbah, giving share. Come to show us your people. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accept. He took them to the masjid. Bani Tamim like ask their person, the person who make, give like share, buttery. He start to give share. Then one of the Muslims, Sayyidina Hassan ibn Thabit, also give like buttery for Islam and Muslims. Then Banu Tamim said, yours are better than us. They admit. Then now khutbah. They ask the person to give khutbah. Their one. He give his khutbah. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also asked one of the Sahaba to give khutbah. His khutbah was totally different and much, much better than the khutbah of Banu Tamim. Then they said, your khatib is much better than us. Then they accepted Islam. Al-Aqab ibn Habis, the leader, and his people accepted Islam and took shahada. And then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave also like some gift for them, some reward for them. This is about Al-Aqab ibn Habis. Then very big group came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are Bani Hanifa. I will mention name, maybe you know it. You know Musaylim al-Kazzab? Anyone heard about this name? Musaylim al-Kazzab. It's very famous, right? Musaylim al-Kazzab. He is the leader of Bani Hanifa. Bani Hanifa is 100,000 person. It's huge. It's the same number of the army of Roman Empire. It's a huge number. So Bani Hanifa alone, like this big tribe, 100,000 person. They came, not all of them, of course, like the people who are representing this big tribe. They came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to accept Islam. They like saw what is going on and they accept Islam, no problem, okay. But every one of them entered Medina except Musaylim al-Kazzab himself. He stayed outside of Medina. He couldn't, he didn't want to meet Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam face to face. Then they spoke with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They asked him, please like explain Islam to us. He explained Islam to them. They said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka Rasulullah. It's okay, everything is okay. He said, Ya Rasulullah, there is someone, he is our master, Musaylimah, his name is Musaylimah. But he is outside Medina, he didn't come. He said, what he is doing? He said, he is taking care of our like camels and horses and like, taking our, like, he said, if he do that, then he's not a bad person. He's okay. And he also sent him some gift. They went to Musaylimah al-Kazzab, and when they went to him, he came back with them to Medina. And now they are sitting in the masjid. Of course, you know that masjid, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his room is connected with the masjid. He just opens the door and enters the masjid directly. So Musaylimah giving his back to the door of the room of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he start to speak with them. They told him, Ya Musaylima, all of us accepted Islam except you. Why are you not becoming Muslim? Why are you not accepting Islam? He said, look, I can accept Islam, but I have one condition. What is your condition? He said, if Muhammad, he didn't say, he didn't say Rasulullah, he said, just if Muhammad, like this, you know, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If he appoint me to be like deputy messenger, like after him, I will be the Khalifa after him. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came and he heard what he said. And then he took some small, we call it oud, some small like wood from on the from the ground, and he said, "Wallahi, it's not about to be caliph. If you even ask me to give you this trivial thing, I will not give it to you." But why? Why is that kind of answer? You know, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is very generous. He can give many things. Why he gives him that strong answer? Because Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw in his dream before he met that guy Musaylimah al-Kazzab that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the treasure of the earth, every treasure, gold and silver and everything in the dream. And then among this treasure he gave him two bracelets on his two hands. But he saw in the dream that he didn't like those two bracelets. He didn't like them. So he did like this, the bracelet fly. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhu asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, what does that mean? Like of this two bracelets and why you did like that?" He said, "Awaltuha bithnain min al-kazzabin." This is in Arabic. So what does that mean? It means that there will be two liars, they will claim that they are messenger of Allah. And that's exactly what happened. That's why he spoke with him very like very strong. That's why he said, "I will never give you anything." Because he knows that he is one of them. Subhanallah, he knows that he Musaylima is one of those two who will claim that they are prophets. So Musaylima went back to Bani Hanif, his tribe, they went back, became Muslim. You speak about 100,000. Not all of them, but many of them, like many of them, became Muslims. Then while Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, Musaylima al-Kazzab sent him message again. Sent to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam message. He said, "Min Musaylima Rasulullah." From Musaylima is the messenger of Allah. To Muhammad, the messenger of Allah. What kind of speaking like this? Min Musaylima, Rasulullah, he speak about himself, he said, "I am the messenger of Allah and you are also messenger of Allah." So both of us are messengers. And I will take half of earth and you take the other half of the earth. We are now partners. So we are two prophets. I will give you half, you give me half. But he said, وَلَكِنَّ قُرَيْشًا قَوْمٌ يَعْدِلُونَ. Quraysh are injustice people. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu from Quraysh. He said, you guys are injustice people. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu gave him answer, message, مِنْ مُحَمَّدِ الرَّسُولِ اللَّهِ. From Muhammad, the prophet, the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To Musaylima al-Kazzab. Musaylima, the liar. أَمَّا بَعْدْ فَإِنَّ الْأَرْضَ لِلَّهِ يُرِثُهَا مَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ. This universe, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala own everything and he decide who will take this or that. Not me, not you, not anyone. Clear. Then one day, Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, this story connected to Musaylima al-Kazzab. You will understand why. One day, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed through three people in Medina. One of them, Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. But focus on this point. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw those three. Among them, Sayyidina Abu Huraira. Everyone knows Sayyidina Abu Huraira is very famous. He said, "One of you will be in hellfire." Allahu Akbar. Can you imagine? Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu sitting and another two people with him. Some of them, one of them from Ansar. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "One of you will be in hellfire." You can imagine? Alaykum as-salamu alaykum. Then Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, when he hears that, like Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said like that, speaking like that, he got shook. And he feels scared on himself. He thought that A'udhu Billah, maybe he will be that person on hellfire. And this is also a message for everyone. Don't think that you are, mashallah, very nice and you will survive, it's very easy. No. Even Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, you know Sayyidina Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, Sahabi, Sayyidina Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him the secrets. And he told him about the name of all munafiqin. After the death of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu went to Sayyidina Huzaifa radiallahu anhu and said, Ya Huzaifa, did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mention me among munafiqin? Can you imagine? Who is asking? Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. You know who is Sayyidina Umar? I will give you just one hadith, you will understand. Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said about him, لو كان نبيا بعدي لكان عمر. If there is a prophet after me, he will be Umar. You can imagine how high level he is. You can imagine how high level he is. If there is a prophet after me, he will be Umar. Even though he knows this hadith, even though he asked Sayyidina Huzaifa, did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mention me among the munafiqin? So if that Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab and speaking like that, what about me and you? What about me and you? So don't think that you are mashallah. No, no, no. Do your best and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept. And ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save you from hellfire. And to enter your paradise inshallah. Don't think that inshallah you are... No, no. No one can guarantee anything for himself. That's why when Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu heard about that hadith from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of you, three of you, one of you will be in hellfire. He got shook. And he feels scared about himself. Then what make him more scared about himself, that one of those three, like Sayyidina Abu Huraira and the other two, one of them from Ansar, he died as shaheed in a battle. As shaheed. So still two, Sayyidina Abu Huraira and the other person. Okay? The other person, his name is Nahar, if I'm not wrong. He was Hafiz, trying to memorize Quran, mashallah, praying every day, five times, Qiyamul Layl. He's a very religious person. Then after he became a knowledgeable person, become alim, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to Bani Hanifa. Bani Hanifa, who? The tribe of Musaylim al-Kazzab. Why? To teach them about Islam, because now they became Muslim, so they need someone to teach them. It's not only about taking Shahada. After taking Shahada, you need someone to teach you what is Islam. And this is also a message for us here in Japan. Many people only focus on giving da'wah until the person, non-Muslim, accept Islam and take Shahada. After that, nothing. Right? The main mission after the person accepted Islam. The main duty. After the person, when the person accepts Islam, your main duty will start. How to teach that person the rules of Islam. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent that person to Bani Hanifa to teach them about Islam, and he was, mashallah, knowledgeable, hafiz and knowledgeable. When he went there, and of course, Bani Hanifa is 100,000. They are a very huge tribe. That Musaylim al-Kazzab, he took that person before he met the people. And he spoke with him. He said, look, if you told my people that I am also messenger of Allah, I will appoint you as a minister. And unfortunately, that person was very poor. Subhanallah, dunya became penetrated his heart in 1 second. Be careful. Be careful. In 1 second. He was a virtuous person, doing his best. Hafiz, have much knowledge. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him to Bani Hanifa to teach them But that person, subhanAllah, fall in the love of dunya and love of position, because he will be a minister. In where? In a huge tribe. It's a huge, 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 a huge number. You can speak about 100,000 person. He accepted what Musaylimah said. Then when the people came to him, they accepted Islam already. They said, what the Messenger of Allah, Sayyidina Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taught to you, like what he said to you, so please teach us. He said, the Messenger of Allah, Sayyidina Muhammad, he lied. He said that Musaylimah also is a prophet. When the people heard that, all of them became murtad. All of them became murtad. They left Islam. And they follow Musaylimah al-Kazzab. So the main point, the mistake of that person is not only damaging himself, it became a damage of 100,000 person. So sometimes the mistake, like the damage of the mistake become only on you. But unfortunately, sometimes it can affect people around you. So what happened? One mistake from that person who accepted Islam before, and he was Hafiz, and he learned many things, affected 100,000 person. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions the hadith, when those three were sitting, Sayyidina Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, and that shaheed from Ansar, and that person, he said, one of you are in hellfire. That's why that person in hellfire. So Musaylimah al-Kazzab started to give his da'wah as he's a prophet, and all of the people in Bani Hanifa followed him. This about Musaylimah al-Kazzab. Third group which came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Bani Tay, Qabila Tay. Qabila Tay is a tribe of Tay. They had some problem with Muslims before. Then the army of Muslims went to their tribe. Before they go to them, Adi ibn Hatim al-Ta'i. This is a master of Bani Tay. His father was the most generous person among Arabs. Akram al-Arab, they call him Akram al-Arab, the most generous person among all Arabs. This is his son, Adi. So Adi spoke to some scholars of Christianity. They have a place, worshipping place, in the middle of Medina and his tribe. So whenever the Muslim army want to go to his tribe, they must pass through this place. So he told them, if you saw the Muslim army, please let me know so I can run. He wanted to run. Who is he? He is the leader of Bani Tay. So he prepared some camels and his money and everything, and now he's just waiting for signal. If that pastor or scholar told him that the Muslim army are coming, he will just leave. The Muslim army went passed through that worshiping place. We call it Sawma in Arabic. The pastor told Adi, the master of Bani Tay, that the Muslim army are coming now. He took his money, his kids, his wife, and he ran away towards to Sham, like Syria and the other places like this. This is called Sham. He is a leader, which means he left his own tribe without defending. He left his own sister and his family. He just took his wife and his kids and his own money and he left. It's a very bad thing, right? Very bad thing. So the Muslim army came and they took controlled the place, and one of those who has been captive, has been captured, the sister of Ali, the sister of the leader of the tribe, his sister. So they took them to Medina and they put them in front of the Masjid al-Nabawi. When that sister, the sister of Ali, saw Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When I say Sayyidina Muhammad, you say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then you will take 10 reward. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself will answer you again. The angels will take your salah to his graveyard and he will answer you. Not only that, they will mention your name and the name of your father. And they will say he is giving salah on you. That's why he will again repeat the answer to you. How honor it will be, you can imagine. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he walked through, like passed through those captives, she stand up and spoke with him. He said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I am the sister of Ali ibn Hatim. I am the highest rank among those people. And please like release me. Because my brother also is very high person. He said, he's very high. That person who ran from Allah and his messenger. The person he ran, right? He ran. He said, your brother ran away from us. How he is high person. 2 times, 2 days, tried with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but the answer is the same. Then 3rd day, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu came. She spoke with him. Yeah, like, I'm very high rank, I'm please release me, like this. So Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came also. Then he said, we will release you. Because you are high rank, we will release you. So then she asked, please, if there is any caravan or a group, merchant group, who are coming, like going to Sham, please send me with them. Because her brother is there. So she want to meet him. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her, if your brother come to us, we will protect him. We will put him in a very high rank and we will respect him. So he should not scare anymore. She went to Sham and she spoke with her brother. When she saw him, she said, you are a coward, you are like this. And because she is very angry from him. Why? Because he left them in the tribe while the Muslim army came. And it's not acceptable thing. Then he made her come down and he starts to speak with her because they are brother and sister. So he said, what is your opinion about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and what happened, please tell me. She said, he is one of two. One of two. Either if he is a king or a prophet. He can't be another thing. He is very high ranked person. You never meet someone same as him in your life. He is either king or prophet. Then you should meet him, you should speak with him. You must speak with him, you must meet him. Then Ali went to Medina according to the advice of his sister. He went to Medina. And he met Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw him, he like gave him very high and warm hospitality and he took care of him and mashallah gave him the best. Because he's also a master of the tribe, he's not a normal person. When Ali went out and walked with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, now he tried to check if he is a prophet or king. You know, most of the kings are arrogant and, you know, prestige and like this, and no one touch him, and you know, that kind of king, you know. While they are walking together, a very old woman stopped Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very old. And she said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to speak with you. He said, yes, of course. He left Adi and he started to speak with the woman. Old woman. And spoke with her for a long time. And he's just waiting. How? How that high rank person who now controls the like Arab, like Peninsula or Arab, like Jazeera Arab, island of Arab, and how he spent all that time with that old woman. It's impossible to be a king. This akhlaq, this manner of a prophet, not a king. Then they went to the house of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When they went to the house of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there is only one small seat, not chair, small seat you can sit like on the ground. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam give it to him. He say, please use it, sit down. So Ali took it and gave it back to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and say, please you sit down. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam again insist to give it to him and say, please sit down. Then he sat down. When Ali saw the house and how simple it is, he said, it's impossible that small and simple house to be the house of the king of Arabs. It's impossible. Impossible. No. This house is a house of prophet. Because Ali also was a scholar, not normal person. So he's a scholar in Christianity and he, mashallah, knew much information. So he knew the life of the prophets. They are all of them simple. Except like a few of them, like Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam and Sayyidina Dawood, they were kings. So yes, their life was much like high. But other prophets, they are very simple. Right? So he saw that kind of situation. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spoke with him about his own belief. Ali have a special belief and a special religion which already disappeared and no one knows about it. It is like between Judaism and Christianity. So he's not 100% clear Christian or 100% clear Judaism. He is something like half. So that kind of religion is disappeared already. And no one knows that he is on that kind of belief except himself. So no one else knew about that. Even his own wife don't know about that. His tribe, no one knows that he is following that kind of belief. He thinks he's a Christian. Like 100% Christian. But he's not. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you are following that kind of religion. He got shocked. How he knows? For example, if you have some secret, only you on the earth will know about it. No one else. You never tell anyone. There's no camera. There's no anything. No one know about it. And someone come to you and say, hey, I know that you are like this. How? Especially at that time, there's no satellite. There's no internet. Right? There's no camera. How? Even his own wife, you know, he's living with his wife years, right? His family, his tribe. No one knows that he is following that kind of belief. But Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, you are following that kind of belief. Not only that, he told him that you are taking some special tax from your people. He said, yes. He said, the name of that tax is Al-Mirba' in Arabic. He said, that tax is haram in your religion. He got shocked. He couldn't believe how he knows that kind of rare religion, which already disappeared at that time, not now. It's already disappeared now, but at that time, disappeared already. And the only person who follows that religion, only Ali ibn Hatim. Only. Not only that, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knows the details of that religion, which disappeared already. When he heard that, Sayyidina Ali like became like from his heart, he 100% prophet. He, Allah, like he already understood that the person in front of him is a prophet. Then Sayyidina Muhammad tried to also clear the misunderstanding. And this also again like a small advice and humble advice to every one of you. This cup, listen to this carefully. This cup have water, right? Water. If this cup is hantai, not like this, it will be hantai. And you want to fill water, it will have water? No. If you bring two bottles, it will have water? No. If you bring the sea itself, it will not have water, right? Why? Because it's hantai. How to do it? Put it on the right way first and clean it, then you can put any water. Right? What does that mean? If a person have bad image about Islam and many fake information he heard from here or there about Islam, so his image and his imagination about Islam is totally negative. Whatever you will say about Islam, it will be the same if this cup hantai and you are filling the water. Only leaking and wasting your time. What is the way to fix that? Fix the cup. So first, change that kind of bad image first, then speak about Islam. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he spoke to Sayyidina Ali ibn Hatim, he said, first you think that Muslims are very poor. He told him, One day you will see that the person who are collecting zakah, he will try to check every house and every door and every street. He will never find someone to take zakah from him. Not to pay zakah. He will never find someone to take zakah from him, a needy person. There's no needy person anymore at that time. He told, Sayyidina Muhammad told him, the Muslims will reach that level. You remember if, can you remember Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz? Sayyidina Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. That Khalifa, at his time, only, his Khalifa only like almost 2.5 years or 3 years. At the time of his Khalifa, there's no any fakir anymore, no poor person. No one takes the zakah. No one. All of the people have money. That's the same what Sayyidina Muhammad SAW told. He told him, you think that Muslims are weak. Remember my word, you will find a woman coming from Sana'a in Yemen to Hadramaut or another place alone, and no one will even cut her road or touch even her. She will be 100% safe, which means Islam will prevail in everywhere. He said, you will find Muslims one day taking the palace of Babel, Babel in Iraq, They will control the palace of Babel. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, I saw that by my eye. Muslims reach Iraq there, like Persian empire, and they took the palace there, and they instead of like living in tent, they are living now in palace. So life is totally different. When Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu saw all these things, he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. When he accepted Islam, all his tribe accepted Islam also. So sometimes, when you focus with some person who is high level among his people, his Islam may become a reason for the Islam of all the people are following him. So try, if some person is high level, try to give him more importance and more time. It doesn't mean that the people who are not in the same level are lower than him. A'udhu billah. No, I'm not saying like that. I'm saying if you focus with that kind of characters, their Islam, the impact of their Islam will affect the followers who are following him. That's what I mean. But of course, as a Muslim, we are seeing everyone is same level. Minna biyulu. Everyone is same. One of the groups also, a tribe, they were like confused. They like suspecting if Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam really is a prophet or not. They have some person among them, he has that kind of skill, we call it farasa. Farasa means he just look at your face one time, he know if you are saying the truth or lying. Just one time. That kind of level. We call it farasa to Arab. So that person have that kind of skill. So they said, oh, you are the best person in that skill. So please go to Muhammad in Medina, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and speak with him. See if he's a liar or he sees the truth. That person came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he said, I will ask you, and I will speak with you very strictly. So please be patient, because I will speak with you very like strict. He said, okay. He asked him, who created the heavens? And he now focused on the face of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He tried to see if he's lying or what is going on. He said, Allah. Direct answer with full confidence. He said, who created the earth? He said, Allah. He said, who created these mountains and made it like a balance of the earth? He said, Allah. He said, by Allah, who created these heavens and this earth and these mountains, are you the messenger of Allah? He sent you to us? He said, yes. That person have farasa, a special skill. He don't need much time to understand if that person in front of him is liar or saying the truth. When he saw Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam speaking by that way, and how much he is honest and how much he is speaking directly, he said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu annaka Muhammad Rasulullah. Directly. And then he went back to his people and said, "Oh my people, he is a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Accept Islam." All of them accepted Islam, alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah. Another group, and they are also very huge number. Actually, they are same as Bani Hanifa. 100,000 person. Who is those people? Bani Najran. You heard this name, I think. Bani Najran. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bani Najran is a Christian tribe. They are 100,000 person. Very huge group. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent one message to them, to invite them to Islam. Who received the message? The highest scholar among Bani Najran. He received the message from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he read the message, and he tried to compare it with Torah and the Injil, the Old Testament and New Testament. But it's nothing called Old Testament actually or New Testament. It's originally Torah and Injil. Nowadays it's corrupted, of course. So he still have some original text. I'm not saying everything was like original, but they have many things original at that time. So he compared what is going on and what is written in Torah and Injil. He found out that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. He became sure, 100%. You understand? Because it's written in Torah and Injil at that time that there is one more prophet, and from Bani Ismail, from the generation of Sayyidina Ismail alayhi salam, not from Bani Israel, not from Sayyidina like Ishaq. He would be from Ismail, from Arab. They know that it was written like that. It was written like that. So that scholar went to the master of Bani Najran. That person was very, very smart, the master. Very smart. So he asked his opinion, what do you think? I compared that message, which I received from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it's matching whatever mentioned in Torah and Injil, and you know that we're still waiting for one more prophet, and he is from Arab, from Bani Ismail. He said, what you can give us as advice? He said, if it's something from dunya, if it's like problem or something in dunya, I can give you, you know how much I'm smart I am, and I can give you, but this is a religious point. I can't help you in this. Please, you give us the opinion. He asked the scholar, please, you give us the opinion. So the scholar said, I suggest if we send a group, official group, to speak with the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, okay. Then he and the master of Bani Najran and some other scholars went to Medina. They wear very, very high level of clothes and put gold. They are men, but they put gold. And you know, gold is haram in our religion. So like to show that they are very high and prestige and that kind of mentality. They came into the masjid to speak with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't answer them. He didn't even speak with them. I speak about Bani Najran, 100,000 person. The group which are representing them came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he didn't answer anyone. Then they went back outside the masjid, then try to make mashwara to each other, and again went back to a masjid to speak with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He didn't answer them. Then they went back again. Then some of Sahaba told them that the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, never, never, ever like that kind of clothes or to see gold with a man. It's not like that. Then they changed the clothes, put like humble clothes and took off the gold and came back to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When they came back, he spoke with them. By that kind of clothes. Then Sahaba after that meeting asked him, Ya Rasulullah, why you didn't speak with them from the beginning? In the first time and second time, why? He said, because of that kind of clothes and that kind of gold they are putting and that kind of arrogance, they came, while they are coming, I saw Iblis with them. Iblis came with them in the two times. So he said, I didn't speak with them because of that reason. Then he started to speak with him. He explained to us please about Islam. He started to explain. Then they asked him about Isa alayhi salam, Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, Jesus. Who is Jesus? How you Muslims like believe in Jesus? Who is he? What is your definition about him? He recited the verse which mentioned in Surah Al-Imran. Inna mathala Isa 'inda Allah ka mathali Adam. خلقه من تراب ثم قال له كن فيكون. He said Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam is the same as Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam. Even Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam more special than him. Why? If you say that Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam was born by miracle way, right? Miraculous way. Why? Because he don't have father. He came only from mother, right? His mother Mary. So this is a big miracle. For that miracle, they say, because of that, because he came only from Father, it means he is God. Because of that. They think like that. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam refuted their allegation. He said, if you think like that, because he came from mother only, not father and mother, then he is a God. Then how about Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam? He came from no father, no mother. Right? No father, no mother. So Sayyidina Adam alayhi salam have no father, have no mother. This bigger miracle than Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, who has been created from mother, but there is no father. So both of them are prophets. We believe in them as a prophet. Then they start to consult with each other. How, what should we do? Then they said, now we are confirmed that he is a prophet. خلاص, like they are 100% confirmed that he is a prophet. But they say, we don't want to become a Muslim. SubhanAllah. Hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not from you or me or anyone. Hidayah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They didn't accept Islam. But they said, his akhlaq, we speak about Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's a generous person. His akhlaq, his manner is very high. So based on that, let him decide about us. Not us to decide, no. We will let him decide about us because we know that he is a justice person. They went to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, we don't accept to become Muslim, but we accept your judgment. You can judge. He said, okay, if you don't accept Islam, then you pay jizya for me. Jizya is money to pay it, and for paying that kind of money, the Muslim army will protect you. If you like for your own company and appointing some bodyguard, for example, you are paying money, right? You are paying money, it's not for free. So the kind of jizya they are paying, and Muslim army will protect them. They don't even need to be in the army. It's us who will protect them. And the amount of jizya is less than zakah. So as a Muslim, I'm paying 2.5% every year. They are paying less than this. And we are protecting them. So we are paying zakah and we are inside the army. Right? You are as a Muslim, you inside the army. But they are not joining the army. And paying less than you, and living in the same country as you. So it's totally different. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives him that kind of judgment. They accept, and they went back to Bani Najran. Bani Najran, before they accept and like became sure that he's a prophet, he told them one thing. And that thing mentioned in Surah Al-Imran. We call it in Arabic Al-Mubahala. Al-Mubahala means to bring their group, and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will bring his own family. And then both of them, this group and Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his family will raise their hand, and they will make dua that may Allah curse who is liar and who is following the wrong way. He told them, are you ready to do that? If you don't accept me as a prophet, are you ready to do that? I will bring my family. You bring like your group. We come outside. We will make dua together. Whoever following the wrong way and lying, may Allah curse him now. When they heard this word, and of course they know that he's a prophet, say, no, we can't. We will be cursed if we do that. So please give us your judgment, and they accepted his judgment. Later, Bani Najran, Islam spread among them, and mashallah, many of them became Muslims. One Arabi came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Arabi is a person who is living in the desert. He came, Ya Rasulullah, what is like Islam? What should I do? He said, Islam is like five pillars, shahada, salah, zakah, siyam, hajj, like this. He said, okay, if I pray every day five times, and I make those, like protect those five pillars, I will pray five times, I will make fasting, of course I took shahada already, and I will make hajj. Is that enough to enter paradise? He said, if you do it with good intention and without like, cutting, then inshallah it will be a reason to enter paradise. When he left, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Sahaba, aflaha in sadaq. He will be in paradise if he is honest, if he is not lying. So Islam is not very tough as people think. Islam is easy, alhamdulillah. But it's us who should learn and understand what is Islam. This is like the main point. What is Islam? This is the main point. Later, another groups came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and asked about Islam. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them about Islam. And mashallah, Islam is spread in the whole Arab countries. This is in the ninth year of Hijrah. So we still have one more year, 10th of Hijrah, then the beginning of 11th of Hijrah, because of, like, it will be the death of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the ninth year of Hijrah, his daughter, Sayyidina Umm Kulsum radiallahu anha, died. In the ninth year of Hijrah. Actually, all of his kids, he got seven. Just to remind you, four kids, four boys, and three sons and four daughters. Three sons only and four daughters. The sons is Al-Qasim, Abdullah, and Ibrahim. Again, Al-Qasim, Abdullah, Ibrahim. From daughters, four. Sayyidina Fatima is the youngest. Umm Kulsum, Ruqayya, Zainab, and Sayyidina Fatima. All of his kids died in his during life. All of them, except Sayyidina Fatima only, radiallahu anha. She died after him only after 6 months. You can imagine how she experienced that kind of sadness. His kids, seven of them, six of them died in his life. And not only that, when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam spoke to Sayyida Fatima radiallahu anha, and he told her that he will die soon, that's why she was crying very much. Then he told her another thing, that's why she became happy. Why she became happy? Because he told her that you will die after me. Directly. She became happy that she will be able to meet him in the hereafter, like in, after this life. So Sayyida Fatima radiallahu anha died after him just after 6 months. And he knows that his daughter will die after him directly. So all of his kids already died, and he knows. He knows that even the last remaining daughter, she will also die after him directly. Can you imagine how he suffered in his life? You can imagine how he suffered to give us that kind of deen. So now, last point, because inshallah, we have another lecture next Sunday, inshallah. His, we call it Hajjat al-Wada. Hajjat al-Wada is which year? Hajjat al-Wada, the last Hajj. Farewell Hajj, pilgrimage. 10th of Hijra. In 9th of Hijra, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu for Hajj. So this information many people doesn't know about it. In 9th of Hijra, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu to perform Hajj and to be a leader of Hajj. This means Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم giving that kind of position to Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He is the person who leads the Hajj. He is the highest after Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he is the person who leads the prayer while Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم was like sick before he died. So anyone come to you and they say Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu not like deserving the khilafah, does make sense. Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم appointing him already to lead the Hajj and to lead the prayer. If he is trustworthy in religion, in religious matter, he will not be trustworthy in hukm, in being a leader. So it's clear for everyone. So Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu went to perform Hajj in 9th of Hijra. But Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't. So it's not in the 9th. Next year, 10th of Hijra, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took the Sahaba and everyone who became Muslim and they went to perform Hajj. How many they were? They were 100,000. You can imagine in Fath Mecca, to conquest of Mecca in 8th of Hijra, 2 years before, they were only 10,000 person. After 2 years, they became 100,000 person. You can imagine. You can imagine, even in Tabuk, Battle of Tabuk, they were 30,000 person in the 9th of Hijra. Just after 1 year, from 30,000, they became 100,000. Inshallah, we will speak about that next lecture, inshallah. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين.